Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
We're talking about healing, and we're talking about healing as a redemptive truth. Remember that? That is the basis of everything we're talking about. And where do we get that healing as a redemptive truth from? Come on, guys. What four letters? Okay, which in the King James is translated in little caps, Lord. Okay, we translate it Yahweh or Jehovah. Comes from the same words. It is the covenant name of God. There are seven hyphenated covenant names. One of them being YHWH, Rapha, which is the Lord that heals thee. And that's even translated the Lord that healeth thee, you know, the Lord thy physician. But it's all talking about the same thing, okay? So YHWH is what they call the unpronounceable name of God everywhere in your King James Bible and some other translations. When you see the word Lord in small caps in the Old Testament, it comes from this. And it, we put the vowels in it to get Yahweh. The Germans put the, you know, transferred the J for the Y and the V for the W and came up with Jehovah, okay? That's where those words come. They come from the same Hebrew word. And it is the covenant name of God. Okay. We are in a it is a redemptive reality. It's just as much part of redemption as being spiritually saved. Okay? All right? And so this is our whole basis of teaching. Like we said, there's seven compound covenant names. You know, Jehovah Shalom, the Lord is peace. Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that heals thee. Jehovah Tsidkenu, you know, Jehovah Nisi, the Lord is our banner of victory. You know, we got all those different names that they're translated. And this is the first one. The very first compound covenant name in Exodus 15:26 was Jehovah Rapha. Okay? The Lord that heals thee. It is a covenant name of God. And so we talked about that for several weeks. Now we're on the healings in the ministry of Jesus. To recap last week, we said there are 32 recorded healings in the Gospels. There are 19 different ones. In other words, the synoptic gospels cover the same healing more than once. As here, Simon's mother-in-law, Matthew, Mark, and Luke cover that same story. So it's that those three add up to part of the 32, but since it's one story, it's part of the 19. There are 19 different healings. Okay? So in these three, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 of the 32, but only 3 of the 19. Y'all with me? Okay, and then we said this, out of the 19, Jesus, or the scriptures, tell us that 7 of them were because of their faith. The other, I've got that backwards. Sorry. Not 7 of them. Totally messed myself up. 12 are because of their faith. Okay, 7 was other. In other words, somebody's intercession, gifts of the Spirit, okay? One of those things. So we said this, that the weight of people being healed in the Scriptures is on their faith. Okay? The evidence and the weight of how people got healed was by their faith and not because of a manifestation of the Spirit or the intercession of another. Okay? All right? We thank God for that. Because there are people who will never get healed other than this. And there are many people who start out in the Christian walk who were healed by a gift of the Spirit or somebody's interceding for them where they didn't get it by faith, who now are required to get it by faith and later walk out and receive by faith. But the majority, the majority of people that were healed under the ministry of Jesus were healed because of their faith. Okay? And you'll listen to people teach, Jesus healed the woman with the issue of blood to prove he was divine. He said your faith made you whole. See? Well, and we'll get to her. She's about number 17 or 18 in our list. So, all right. So let's go tonight. We'll start off with number 4. I guess I could start over here. I better bring my thing over here because I'm going to tell you what. Paralytic. The paralytic. We have 3 scripture references for this one, I think. Come on, calm down here. Matthew 9, 2 through 8. Mark 2, 1 through 12, and then, okay, and then Luke 5, 17, that's a 5, by the way, 17 through 26. Okay, so we have these three different references. Let's read from Luke's account, if you will. Let's go to Luke chapter 5. Luke 5. Ellie says she enjoys me teaching with the marker board. It slows me down and she can write stuff down. Hallelujah. It came to pass on a certain day, verse 17. He was teaching that there were Pharisees and doctors of the law sitting by, which were come out of every town of Judea, Galilee and Judea, and Jerusalem, and the power of the Lord was present to heal them. Now, wait a second now. We've got a story here about the paralytic. It starts out here in Luke, where we use Luke's gospel. And it says that there were doctors and lawyers, they were from everywhere, and what? The power was present. To do what? To heal them. Not just power of the Lord was present, it was present to heal them. Who? The doctors, lawyers, from every town around Judea, Galilee, and Samaria. All those guys that were in the house, the power of the Lord was present to heal them. That's what it says. Isn't that what it says right there? And the power of the Lord was present to heal them. Now I'm just going to tell you ahead of time, none of them got healed. Not one single person in that room at the time they made this statement got healed. But the power was present to heal them. Let me ask you a question. Just hang on now. I'll show you. I'll prove it to you because we're just going to read a little bit. I'm going to tell you. I'm setting this up. If the power was present to heal them, then it must have been God's what? Will. It had to be God's will. To what? Heal them. He wouldn't have put his power. That's like taking starving people and putting food there and saying, and there was food for them to eat, but you can't eat. Hello? God's word says his power was present to heal them. None of them got healed, but I am telling you because it was there, it was his will to do it. God doesn't do things without a purpose. He did not send his power and have it available to those people to pull it away from them and say, I'm sovereign, I can do what I want to do. No, what? The Lord is full of compassion. The Lord is full of mercy. His mercies are new every morning. You go back to, you read about God, he's love, he's compassion, he's full of mercy. And what? Healing is a mercy of God. And so that power is present to heal them. None of them got healed. Let's continue reading. Where was I? Verse 17, 18, okay. And behold, now this is talking, this is after the fact. Men brought in a man in a bed, which was taken with a palsy, and they sought by means what to bring him in and to lay him before him. So now they go, they get here. This house is full. Who's it full of? It's full of Pharisees, doctors of the law, from Galilee, Judea, and Jerusalem. They're in there. The power's present to heal them. All of a sudden, these guys show up with a paralytic. And behold, they come. And man was taken with a palsy, sought by means what to bring him in, to lay him before him. And when they could not find by what way they might bring him in, what? He's not in that room when the Bible says the power of the Lord was present to heal them. And besides that, it said them, plural. But who's the subject? If you know anything about language, the subject is the doctors and the lawyers from every town in Galilee, Judea, and Samaria. I mean, in Jerusalem. That's the subject of the power of the Lord was present to heal them. Now they come and they bring some guy with palsy. This guy's got palsy. Did I get that right? Okay. All right. and sought to bring him in. They couldn't find a way to get him in. They went up on the housetop and let him down through the tiling with his couch in the midst before Jesus. Now, what'd they do? They climbed up and ripped the roof off. They got a meeting going on. Their buddy has been in this crippled, paralytic state for some time. They get there. They can't even get in the house. And the power of the Lord's in there. They climb up on the roof. It'd be like being in here. All of a sudden, you hear somebody with a metal cutting saw. And all of a sudden, sparks start flying, and the roof opens up. Next thing you know, here comes ropes letting some guy down in the middle of the church service. Because it was so crowded, you couldn't get in. Can you envision that? See, in that day, it was just, you know, it was a clay tile or whatever. And when he saw their faith, now we're going to have to go ahead and put an F over here. The F stands for faith, the O stands for other. We already know their faith is involved. This isn't a manifestation of the Holy Ghost as far as working of miracles or gifts of healings. Faith is involved. And how did he see their faith? He saw the action of their faith. They wouldn't take no for an answer. They refused to accept no. No was not an answer. What do you mean no was not an answer? They got there, they couldn't get in. There's a lot of folks, oh, well, must not be God's will. I can't get in the door. I guess the Lord wants me to suffer this way. I guess God's put this on me to teach me a lesson because I came all this way and I can't even get in the room and I'm just going to have to go home sick. The man, let me tell you something. It takes, what you say, their faith, all their faith, the four men. See, you get people in faith with you, you can get some stuff done. And this was corporate faith. So maybe put a little C in front of this. This is corporate faith. It's the individual plus his buddies. Because they didn't go, oh, well, Joe, we tried. We did the best we could do. But I'm going to tell you, I read Job last week, and I'm one of Job's counselors. There's a reason you can't get in. And the Lord knows what it is. We don't. And maybe one day in the sweet by and by, we'll all get to have figure it out. But no, they climbed that roof and ripped the roof off and let him down. And he said to them, or unto him, to the man, man, thy sins are forgiven thee. Well, there went the theological discussion for the day. Whatever they were talking about just went out the window because now they're on a whole new subject. Are you here? And the scribes and the Pharisees began to reason, saying, who is this that speaketh blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God alone? And when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answered and said unto them, why reason you in your hearts? Which is easier, or whether easier is to say, thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, rise up and walk? Now stop. Why? What we talked about before. Remember we talked about our second point in the teaching on the redemptive truth. Remember, point number one was it's the covenant of God. Number two, it was what? Sin and healing were taken care of with what? Same sacrifice. Come on. I'm trying to get you to talk. Why? Because that helps you reinforce what you're learning. The same sacrifice was offered for your sickness that was offered for your sin. And we use Isaiah 53, verses 3 through 5. 1 Peter 2, verse 24. Matthew 8, 16 and 17. Psalm 103, verses 1 through 4. We use this as the foundation to that. Jesus is the propitiation for our sins, and he is the healer of our bodies. And it took place with the same sacrifice at the same time. When Jesus went to the cross, he took your sin, and he took your sicknesses. And so Jesus comes along, and see, guys, some things are prophetic in action. This was a prophetic action. Okay? This guy comes in. He wouldn't take no for an answer. No was not an answer. Him and his friends, they get up on the roof. They let him down. Jesus looks down at him. And, you know, you got all these religious folk in there. And he just messes them up. They're waiting to see him work the miracle. He looks at the guy and says, your sins are forgiven you. And boy, you got a hubbub going on. They're sitting there talking. Woo, what's he talking about? What are you talking about? This is blasphemous. He's talking. Who can forgive sins but God? But then Jesus comes back. He really even messes them up even more. but that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins. He said to the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, arise, take up the couch, and go into thine house. Immediately he arose before them, took up whereon he lay, departed to his own house, glorifying God. Oh, whoa! You talk about messing them up. Not only now, they're talking about who can forgive sins. He works a miracle to prove he can forgive sin. They all were amazed. They glorified God, were filled with fear. And they said, we've seen strange things today. All right? So what is Jesus is teaching a lesson here. Now, faith is involved in the man being healed, but then Jesus declares what? It is just as easy. Most people don't believe this, to get healed as it is to get saved. Because you get the same sacrifice. The same sacrifice is in manifestation. The same sacrifice is used to procure both. If we can learn, like we said last week, remember last week, the leper, he said, I know you can. If you will, I know you can. Jesus said, I will, and he was healed. He had to change his I know you can into I know you will. Remember that? If we can get people to see that Jesus is the sacrifice, Jesus is the sacrifice, that it's just as it, am I backwards? I'm on that right side. I was trying to save me room for over here. It's just as easy to get healed as it is to get saved, because it's the same sacrifice. And this is what Jesus said. Which is easier? Isn't that what he said? He said, whether it's easier to say that sins be forgiven thee, or to say rise up and walk. Jesus was saying either one. The master said, did I spell declare right? I don't look right. Is it right? Okay, thank you. You ever do that? You ever sit down tight in your sight and you're going, I don't look right. Spell check. Okay, it's right. All right. I don't have a spell checker up here. Okay, I got a cap on the back right. Jesus asked the question, which is easier? Apparently, it's just as easy either way. Because we had the same sacrifice offered on behalf of either case. One physical, one spiritual. Hallelujah. So the palsy is healed through a corporate faith. But Jesus uses the object lesson at the time to teach them and to reiterate our point we made a couple weeks ago about that he is God's double cure, that healing and salvation belongs to us because it's the same sacrifice. And Jesus teaches that to them in this story. Hallelujah. I say glory to God. See, we make it harder to get healed than we do to get saved. And why is that? Because we've been carnal beings. We are more convinced of what we feel and what we see and what we taste and what we hear and smell than we are of the reality of God. If I've got pain, then I'm not healed. Now, how did you know you got saved? Did you feel saved? I heard Dad Hagen telling a story one time. They went out on the Navajo Indian Reservation out there. There was a missionary. And they had this big Navajo Indian or Native American. Okay. My family's part Cherokee. My wife's family's all got Cherokee all in them. And they don't get uptight about calling them Indian. Matter of fact, I went up to the Eastern Band Reservation in Cherokee a couple years ago. And we had the driver that was driving something down the river to the tube. He was a Cherokee Indian. And he didn't bother him. He said he spoke Indian. In the Museum of the Cherokee Indian, the Eastern Band of the Cherokee Nation, you know, they got the Museum of the Cherokee Indian. It's Cherokee Indian. So we need to get over getting touchy about everything in life. My goodness. Anyway, had this Navajo, and he was a big old fella, and he was a drunk. And she'd be preaching, and he'd just walk in and tear chairs up and pews up. And just, I mean, they all he beat people up on the reservation. And one night he came in, and they thought, oh, here he is again. He's going to tear the place up. And she was preaching on, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Well, at the end, she gave an altar call. This big old fella got up and walked down there and said, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. And got up and went back to his seat. And they went to him and said, no, you got to come down. You got to pray. What for? You got to pray until you get saved, until you get through with God. He said, what for? He said, you ain't been down there long enough. He said, she said, if I call on the name of the Lord, I'll be saved. I said his name three times. Messed them up. Became one of the best Christians that they had ever known on there. Praise the Lord. So he just he took that step of faith. You know? And but sometimes when it comes to physical things, we feel. See, he didn't get up from there having to feel saved. She said, call on the name of the Lord. I called on him three times, I'm saved. See, there's faith. It wasn't matter if he felt it. See, we get people wanting to feel some experience, want to get a hooba hooba hooba, you know, get goosebumps on their goosebumps, you know, feel some kind of tingle run all over them, you know, to delineate to them they've been saved. I've seen people shout, run, scream, hoop, and holler, and never get nothing. Hello? Shouting in church on Sunday and living like the devil on Monday. Hello? Then you got them coming in that you don't see anything, and they turn out to be wonderful Christians because they came to know God by faith. It's, see, getting saved is not an action of your flesh. It's an act of faith with your spirit. You speak it with your mouth, but it's not an action of, you know, I felt something. Ooh, I feel saved. My God, if you're going to go by that, you're going to have a lot of trouble because you're going to wake up some mornings and you don't feel saved. Hello? You're going to have moments in life you don't feel saved. That don't mean you ain't saved. Well, I'm back, so how do you know? I don't feel saved. No, bozo, that's your flesh. Okay? But because our body has pain or our body has, as we see something, we start going by what we see instead of faith. When we got to come back, just like when you, it didn't matter what you felt when you got saved or didn't feel. You followed the scripture, and by an acceptance of faith, you received the Lord. You were born again. You can receive your healing and be made whole. Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. And so Jesus saw the faith, and they got amazed. All right. Let's look at number five. And I'm going to have to move over here after. We'll go ahead and move back to number five over here. How about that? Okay. We'll pick up with number five right here. We got the impotent man, and this found only one. This is in John 5, 1 through 16, I believe it is. Hallelujah. Glory to God. After there was a feast, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there was at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of impotent folk, of blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the wind. Now, impotent in the feet, legs, they had some part of the body that didn't work, okay? Waiting for the moving of the water, all right? For an angel went down at a certain season into the pool and troubled the water. Now, here what we do we have. We have a sovereign act. Really, this is a manifestation of a gift of the Spirit, okay? So this would go into the category of other, all right? All right? An angel would come down. Trouble the water. All right? And whosoever then first, after the troubling of the water, stepped in, was made whole of whatsoever disease he had. Now, I remember Jesse coming home from high school one day from her Bible class, and the Bible teacher said, well, you know, that pool had a spring 30 miles away, and it would, you know, it was full of all kinds of minerals, and it would bubble over there, and, you know, and I just find it amazing that only one person could get enough out of it to get healed. And it didn't matter what they had. If they got in first, they got healed. They were lame, blind, halt, withered. It did not matter. You're the first one in. You're the first one. You get healed. And then nobody else got healed. Added later. Yeah. I love, you know, the easy answer to everything is it's a mistranslation. Because you're using the RSV, which use the minuscules instead of the majority, or the minor text instead of the majority text. And the RSV used that in the late 1800s, and almost every modern translation from then uses the RSV as the basis of translating, okay, which used the minority text. We know that we have more evidence of the majority text because we get stuff from the Dead Sea Scrolls and from the Latin Vulgate that predates the Greek manuscripts they're using. Okay. Hallelujah. The emperor, and so when Jesus saw him lie, okay, I'm sorry, I jumped over stuff. They were healed of whatever disease they had. Certain man was there, which had been in infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had now been a long time in that case, he said, "Will you be made whole?" And the impotent man said, "Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool, but while I'm coming down, another steps in before me." Now, there ain't a stitch of faith in this guy. There's excuses. "Well, I can't get healed. I'm trying the best I can. I'm doing all I know to do, and I'm trying to get down there. And on my way down, somebody steps right. I mean, I'm right there 2 inches above the water. Some kid dives in and gets healed of whatever." "I've been doing this for 38 years, sir, and I just can't get there quick enough." I mean, you know, if it was modern day, we'd have people setting up all kind of catapults and everything else. You know, they see the water trouble, hit a button, phew. But you better be the first one there, and you better be able to swim, because if you're not, you're going to drown. All right? Jesus said, "Rise, take up thy bed, and walk." And immediately the man was made whole. Now look, we have no evidence. We have no evidence of faith here on the man's part. So we have a gifts of healings. Okay? In manifestation. Now remember what the Bible said about the gifts of the Spirit. They're divided, every man severally as he. Who's the he in that passage? The Holy Spirit. That's why Jesus just didn't empty out the place. Are you here? See, people misunderstand stuff. They're not good. They are, in many cases, they're good Bible students in one arena, but they take the narrative they've been taught in another arena, and they miss what God has to say. Okay? So they come here and they say, this was just sovereign. God wanted to heal him and nobody else. No, there was a manifestation of the Spirit, and it was a gift of healing. Jesus, and what they'll say to people who lay hands on the sick, "Well, if you've got something from God, you can just go empty out the hospital." You can't do that. Jesus didn't empty out Solomon's porch. You can't empty out the hospital. "Well, the Lord showed me that I got all 9 gifts of the Spirit all the time and operating all the manifestations of the Spirit all the time. And you know, praise the Lord, I'm going to go to the hospital and empty it out, and they're going to run you out in handcuffs." Hello? Jesus said the servant is not above the master. And the master went to the one guy because there was a manifestation of the Spirit in operation. Yeah, that means he didn't want to heal everybody. Nope, we have this. We have faith. And if we can teach people to turn their "I know you cans" into "I know you wills," they can receive. This man wasn't going to get healed by faith. How do you know? When Jesus asked him, he came with all the reasons he couldn't be healed. It took a supernatural move to get him healed. Hello? It took a manifestation of the gifts of the Spirit to get the guy healed. He couldn't get it any other way because he was so far over there in unbelief. "Well, sir, I've been here in the water troubles and I just can't get down there fast enough." See, people can get so embalmed in their excuses of unbelief they can't get anything from God. And let me tell you this. When someone's teaching and they're trying to get you to turn "you know he cans" into "I know he wills," or that it's just as easy to get healed as it is to get saved, and all you can do is come up with the excuses that he came up with, you need to start checking and saying, hearing yourself. I'm not going to get anything from God as long as I'm acting like him, unless we have this. And this is why you'll have people running hundreds of miles to a healing meeting. And we're glad. We thank God for the healing anointing on ministries. Thank God. Thank God for prayer calls. But the majority of the body of Christ is going to be in the 12 and not in the 7. We need to get them to the 12. And thank God along the way we're going to have the 7s. We're going to have prayer calls. We're going to have laying on our hands. We're going to have manifestations of the Spirit that's going to reach some of those people in that group of the 7s. But we got to teach them and get as many as we can to that 12 by their faith. Remember, 32 different healings, 32 recorded healings, 19 are different, 12, their faith is credited. Here, the impotent man was in his faith. Jesus says, stand up. He stands up. Not a thing said about his faith. Not a word said about his faith. Are you here? He made whole, took up his bed, walked, and the same day was the Sabbath. The Jews said unto him that was cured, it's the Sabbath day, it's not lawful for you to carry your bed. He said, he that made me whole, see now, what's it? The Lord made me whole. See, listen, you understand, we always want to give credit to the Lord, but there's no part of his faith involved here. The passage doesn't lean to his faith, it leans to a manifestation of the Holy Ghost. He that made me whole told me, take up your bed and walk. And he that was healed did not know who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself or hid himself, a multitude be in that place. Afterward, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, behold, thou art made whole, sin no more. Oh, there goes the grace bunch. Lest the worst thing come on you. And you go live in sin, it's going to get back on you. Now listen, it doesn't mean you can't, if you mess up one time, it's coming back. But you can't live a life outside the blessings of God and outside the covenant of God and outside of the commands of God and outside the dictates of God and expect to walk in all of his blessings, including physical health. Now, Jesus didn't say that he was there because of sin. But he said, don't go sinning. He said, stop sinning. Right. Now, see, the narrative in the extreme grace teaching is that God's going to do it no matter where you're living, how you're living, because you're under grace. And we can't ever talk about sin because that's sin consciousness. Now, let me tell you what true sin consciousness is. That after you've put it under the blood, and after you've asked God to forgive you, you keep repeating itself and talking about how bad off you are because you sinned in the past. That's sin consciousness. I'm a sinner saved by grace. That's sin consciousness. To acknowledge that you just sinned and ask God to forgive you is not sin consciousness. It's called being smart. It's called repentance. It's called letting him cleanse you of all unrighteousness. It is not sin consciousness to acknowledge I just sinned. See, the narrative that people teach is that if I sin, I don't need to repent because it's already under grace. No, stupid. Beloved, if our heart condemns us not, then have we confidence toward God. If your heart is condemning you, you need to repent. Now, if you've repented and your heart is still condemning you, well, it really is. It's the enemy coming from the outside to bring you into condemnation. The Lord's not going to remind you of something you did 5 years ago once you put it under the blood. And if you're still talking about what you did 5 years ago and asking God to forgive you for what you did 5 years ago, that is sin consciousness. You're more conscious of the sins of the past than you are of the righteousness you stand in now. But if you just sinned this afternoon, I don't know, you cussed somebody out driving down the road. They cut you off, you flip them off, and you call them a blankety blank. Blank. Blank, blank. Okay? And you feel bad. You don't go home and put on the grace preacher who tells you, we don't repent, because that shows, you know, that shows a lack of faith in the grace of God. No. Well, Father, I sinned. That action was not pleasing to you. It was not a representation of you. Forgive me and cleanse me with the blood of Jesus. Now you're cleansed. Now you don't bring it up again. Right. To continue to bring that up is sin consciousness. But to deny it and not do anything about it is not grace. Hello? But that's what people teach. They teach that. And not be guilty. All right? So, where are we? Impotent man. All right. Hallelujah. Let's let's try to get one more in. The withered hand. Man with the withered hand. Number six. Man with the hand. This is not a jungle, and the lion's awake. The lion of the tribe of Judah. That's obviously my son in operation over there. And then Luke 6:6-11. Okay, so we have three references to this: the man with the withered hand. They're all about. Let's just read Matthew's. Okay, give Matthew some airtime tonight. Matthew chapter 12, verse 9. When he departed thence, he went into their synagogue. And behold, there was a man which had a hand withered. And they asked him, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath day? That they might accuse him. You got people who are more concerned about whether you did something on the Sabbath than you are that they got healed. They were trying to catch Jesus doing something that broke their religious law rather than this man getting healed. Hallelujah. And he said to them, what man shall there be among you that shall have one sheep and it fall into a pit on the Sabbath day? Will he not lay hold of it and lift it out? How much more is man better than his sheep? Wherefore is it lawful to do well on the Sabbath day? Then he said to the man, stretch forth thy hand. He stretched it forth. It was restored whole like the other. And so what do we have here? We got an O. It's an other. It's either a gift of the manifestation of the Spirit or something along those lines. Intercession. This one's a gift of the Spirit. No declaration of this man's faith, is there? But those bozos were sitting there waiting to catch him. He healed on the Sabbath. Are you here? Now, Mark's gospel says, and after he did that, Jesus asked, is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath, to heal, to do evil, to save life, to kill? They held their peace. When looking round about them, he grieved, hardness of the heart. He said, stretch forth your hand, it's healed, restored. They went forth and straightway took counsel with the Herodians against him, how they might destroy him. And the Bible says in Luke that they were filled with madness and communed one with another what they might do to Jesus. Okay, so here we have this man getting healed supernaturally in church. Now let me just reference another passage. We're going to have to stop right here. Remember the woman who's bowed over? Remember her? And they came. She came, the guy, the synagogue got mad, got up and said, there are 6 days in which to come and be healed. Let them come on those days and not on the Sabbath. And Jesus rebuked them and said, this woman's been in this case 15 years. And ought not this woman, being a daughter of Abraham, covenant God, be healed on the Sabbath? You got people right now who get so mad that people get healed, they say it's the devil doing the healing. And it's the same devil that was running around on the Pharisees back in those days. They said he cast out spirits by the prince of spirits, Beelzebub. Hello? That's what they said about Jesus. He cast out spirits by the power of the prince of spirits, Beelzebub, which means Lord of the flies. Satan is the maggot god. Because flies come out of maggots. So Satan is the maggot god. New book series I'm going to come out with. The maggot god. No, I'm not. I'm just teasing. Praise the Lord. All right. So did you all get anything out of this?
Yes.
All right. So we have a couple tonight. There were others. We had one that was because of faith and corporate faith. And remember, this is a covenant, redemptive reality issue we're dealing with. And we're trying to get people into the place where they're turning their I know he can's to I know he will's, and they're getting them to the place where they understand it's just as easy to get healed as it is to get saved.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.